President, you're about to lose your Air Force aides.
I know. Well, Mr. President. Well, it's been a great time.
These are my daughters. This is Leo. This is Anne.
Yes, we get a family picture with you two girls in front. You in the middle. And you in the...
Right here or...
No, right there.
Okay, good.
Beautiful.
All right.
Now, if your family would excuse you for a moment to come over here.
In the Award of Defense Superior Service Medal to Major Stephen R. Chelander, United States Air Force. Major Stephen R. Chelander, United States Air Force, distinguished himself by exceptionally superior service as the Air Force aide to the President at the White House from July 1986 to June 1988. In this highly visible position, he routinely planned and coordinated numerous events of national and international significance. His role as the Emergency Actions Officer for the presidential travel was accomplished with expertise and professionalism. Major Chelander served as the White House agent responsible for supervising the use of Department of Defense resources supporting Commander-in-Chief travel throughout the world. His performance as military coordinator for the 1987 Economic Summit in Venice and the visit of the Soviet General Secretary Gorbachev to the United States was particularly noteworthy and contributed measurably to the Office of the President and the effectiveness of the White House Military Office. The distinctive accomplishments of Major Chelander reflect great credit upon himself, the United States Air Force, and the Department of Defense. Signed, Frank C. Carlucci.
We have one other chore for this, I think. You should come in.
Attention to orders. The President of the United States has placed special trust and confidence in the patriotism, loyalty, integrity, and abilities of Major Stephen R. Chelander. In view of the special qualities and his demonstrated potential for increased responsibility, he is promoted in the United States Air Force to the rank of Lieutenant Colonel, 23 June 1988, by order of the Secretary of the Air Force. Signed, Larry D. Welch, General, United States Air Force Chief of Staff. Well, I've got to take those off first.
That's already good. Becky, you want me to take that?
Mr. President?
And congratulations again, President.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to have you do that for me.
Well, it's been great having you here. And the only other thing we did was, knowing that you were going to Williams Air Force Base in Phoenix, we brought in the hot weather to sort of acclimate.
Well, hope it's not as humid there as it is.
No, it won't be. No, it'll be different.
All we do is one more group shot.
One more group shot?
Yeah, why don't you come on over?
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. President.
All right. Well, Mr. President, it's been a real honor to serve you and be with you.
Well, I appreciate everything you've done. We're going to miss you.
Well, thank you. I'm going to miss you, too.
Oh, yes, a few little items here. Yes, that's right. And then you do put on civilian clothes.
Not very often.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And since two among you here, I'm sure that bring books home from school now and then for homework. Why, here are some book bags.
Thanks.
Please do it. Well,
did you want to ask him anything or say anything
about it? I'm excited about going back to California when you're done serving.
Well, I have to tell you that Californians do have a way of being homesick all the time they're working in California.
That's right.
So, yes, it'll be nice to go back. On the other hand, there are things to miss here and a few things that we didn't get done. regret not getting through the Congress and so forth, but maybe out there I can make speeches about it and the people will tell the congressman to vote for him. Get him done.
I'm glad my dad got to work with you because I get to say goodbye to you.
Well, and it's my pleasure. Well, it really isn't a pleasure to say goodbye to you. It's my pleasure to see you. Yes.
Well, thank you, Mr. President. Like I say again, it's been a real honor.
God bless you.
Thank you, and God bless you.
Well, goodbye.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.
I'm sad I got to say goodbye to you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Thanks. Well, thank you.
Yes, sir.
Well, I hope you put
all part of the official duties.
Thank you.
Between Lebanon and the United States. A friendship evergreen and strong against the
stars. Three down.
Yes.
Gave it to Kennedy. Another thing like this.
20 years ago.
All lower. Yes.
Yeah. Lower and lower.
I think.
Here, why don't
you? Save it.
There we go.
California, we know about the Cedars Correct. We have a hospital name. Thank you very much.
It is too late to sign here.
Because you have serious
for us. Well, I think we have a few minutes we could sit down and talk.
Mark, yes. One more.
Why don't you take the chair there? Assistance and political support. But, I know the upcoming election is a very important one for Lebanon, and you have a unique role to play in that. So I'm sure that you will do all that you can to urge or ensure Christian support for a peaceful, orderly election.
I have to thank you, Mr. President, for all you have done for Lebanon. And I saw you are doing much. And I saw what sacrifices the United States has made in favor of peace in Lebanon. And you know that many ties.
Los Angeles chapter of Young Presidents Organization.
Yes, I know you're in. But I just had to come in here and see a bunch of young presidents. Jim, be reminded that I no longer classify.
This is Jim Ellison, chapter president.
Hello. Nice to see you.
Keith Coburn.
Hello. We need to, the scope didn't go off for your picture.
Okay.
Well, that's a greater trick.
Thank you.
I think we all ought to look that way so we're not getting profiles.
Thank you. Thank you.
Brian Corville.
Yes, Bill.
Hello, Mr. President.
Thank you.
Dennis Dugan.
Hello there.
Thank you.
Hi, Marty Shook.
Thank you.
Hello.
Thank you.
Dennis, thanks. Mr. Solomon, pleasure.
Thank you.
Greg Edwards.
Thank you.
Bill Tilly.
I just really.
Thank you.
Ethan Barmark.
Hello, dear.
Thank you.
You know Carl Kovitz, Mr. President, that presents.
Nice to see you, Mr. President.
Hello.
Hello.
Thank you.
Thank you.
How are you?
Thanks for recognizing.
Thank Bob.
I think I should tell you something, though, that you know there are three signs of advancing years. First, you begin to forget things. Can't remember the other two. This hole is from there.
Don't be shy.
Squish.
And you need to position yourself so that you can very clearly see the camera, and then it will be able to see you. Come in much closer over on this side, please. This gentleman, that's great. I'm going to have you even in tighter. Yeah, maybe that's good. Okay. Thank you very much.
Mr. President, I know you're on a tight schedule, but maybe one Russian story.
Was Russia what you had anticipated, or was it very different?
There was one big surprise, never having been there, and that is after all the years of propaganda, I wasn't prepared for the warmth and friendliness of the people. No matter if it was evening, we were going someplace in the limo in the daytime, I don't know how they found out the streets would be lined with thousands of people, and you couldn't ask for a warmer greeting. And then there were, sometimes when we actually got out and were able to meet them in Red Square, and they just came at you with extended hands and the most smiling warmth you've ever seen. And these are just the rank and file. And Nancy went to the, I can't remember, one of the great writers of tunes when we were in the meeting. And there were some elderly women there, and they recognized her. Well, they were, some of them crying, they were embracing, they were telling how happy they were to see her and all of that. Wonderful. But those stories that were, that he mentioned, I have a new hobby. It is amazing. They've got a great sense of humor, those people. And they also have a sort of cynical viewpoint on their system, like a lot of Americans do. And so I collect these jokes that I can actually confirm are their jokes, told by them. And one of the first ones that I ever got, I told to Gorbachev when we met. And that was the usual thing of an American and a Russian arguing about their countries. And the American said, look, I can walk into the Oval Office, I can climb the president's desk, and I can say, Mr. President, I don't like the way you're running our country. And the Russian said, I can do that. American said, you can? He said, yes. I can walk into the Kremlin, into the General Secretary's office, pound his desk, say, Mr. General Secretary, I don't like the way President Reagan's running his country. One about that he that an order had gone out that anyone caught speeding was to get a ticket. Well, you know, that's pretty significant there because most of the automobiles are driven by the nomenclatura, as they call it, bureaucracy. In fact, when we flew in to Moscow, and down there was a freeway that was as big and grandiloquent as anything that we left with that. The clover leaves and so forth, only no automobiles. Finally, we did see one little automobile creeping along on that thing. Well, anyway, they were to get a ticket. So Gorbachev came out of his dacha, his country home one morning, late getting to the Kremlin. His driver and the limo were there. He told his driver, you get in the back seat, I'll drive. And down the road he went, past two motorcycle cops. One of them took out after him, came back a little while later. His buddy said, did you give him a ticket? And he said, no. Well, he said, what? He said, we're told we were to give anybody a ticket. He said, oh, no, this one was too important. Well, he said, who was it? He said, I couldn't recognize it. The driver was Gorbachev. But you're talking about the difference between two systems. I've got to tell them one caught up with. One of our Secret Service agents told it to me after we got home from the trip. He'd heard it over there. Gorbachev and I were in the limo. I had my top Secret Service man. He had his top security man with him. Sightseeing. Took us out and there was a great waterfall. Stopped by the waterfall, all got out. Gorbachev said to my agent, he said, go ahead, jump, go over the fall. And my man said, I got a wife and three kids. He turned to his own man and says, oh, jump, go over the fall. And over he went. Well, my man clambered down the rocks around to the base to see what had happened and found the fellow down there wringing out his clothes. And he said, well, why did you do that? Why did you jump when he told you to jump? He said, I got a wife and three kids.
Thank you very much.
I'll close with just one. Chernenko is dead. Met Saint Peter, and Saint Peter said to him, you can't come in here, of course, you're an atheist. And he said, you have to go down to hell. But he said, you've got a choice. There's two hells, communist hell and the capitalist hell. Well, Chernenko said, I'll choose the communist hell. And Saint Peter said, well, I think you ought to know the capitalist hell is a little more comfortable. And he says, yes, but the communist hell is the only one where I can be sure that the heating system will fail. He told me to tell you. Well, you're doing a great job here for us.
Thank you.
Well, thank you very much.
You're doing a great job for us.
Thank you.
We'll look forward to seeing you in Los Angeles. We'll look forward to seeing you in Los Angeles.
Kind of looking forward to it. All right.
Thank you.
Good to see you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I can't resist. Sometimes when I get a group like this in here, I have to tell them, you know, this is the Roosevelt Room. And that is the Nobel Peace Prize that Teddy Roosevelt won for settling the Russo-Japanese War. And I like to tell a group, sometimes I take a chance on their political leanings, that he did that, won that, in a typical Republican fashion. When he settled that.